The agenda's Week in Review revisits our conversation with Canadian astronaut Jeremy Hansen and explores the security of our energy infrastructure.
At what point does it actually sink in with you that you're going to be the first Canadian ever to take a shot at the moon?
Yeah, I think it maybe hasn't completely sunk in. Certainly every once in a while, you know, I'll look up at the moon and I'll be like, wow, I'm like really going there. And I kind of have to convince myself that it's true and it's really happening. You know, right now it just seems like it's words, but I know. I mean, we're already been working on it. We're starting to dig into some of this stuff. I've got emails about training plans, and yeah, Canada's really going to the moon. It's incredible.
And tell us about the main goal of your Artemis II mission.
Yeah, so Artemis II will be the first time we fly humans on this new spacecraft called Orion, which we will need for future space or for missions to the lunar surface. But this mission will be to buy down the risk, to do that testing of this capsule, and we'll fly it around. We'll leave Earth, we'll orbit the Earth a couple of times. So it'll take about 24 hours to do that, check out all the systems. And then once we're convinced it's ready for deep space, then we're gonna take it around the moon, one lap around the moon. It'll be about a 10-day mission total. We're gonna do manual flying, manual piloting of the spacecraft to assess its docking capabilities. We're gonna test out its life support equipment. We're gonna test out exercise methodology and just figure out how to do exploration in deep space again.
How well do you know the other members of the crew?
Oh, I know my crew really well. Reed Wiseman and I were classmates. We joined the astronaut corps at the same time. So I've been down here in Houston with him since 2009. We went through all our basic training together. He's one of my best friends. And then Victor and Christina, they were the class after us. So we're actually pretty close. We spent a lot of time together socially since they joined the corps, and I've worked with them tons professionally. I've got a great deal of respect for everybody on the crew.
For missions to actually be successful, do you have to like the members that you're going to be up there with?
I don't think that that's an absolute criteria. Of course, professionally, you could work through something like that, and that won't be an issue in our case. In fact, you know, even in our corps, our broader astronaut, our international astronaut corps. So Canada has 4 active astronauts, but we're part of a much larger corps, over 60 astronauts down here in Houston. And we spend a lot of time on that because although you could get the mission done, we've come to recognize that if you're firing on all cylinders, if you're really working on those team skills, you know, empathy, taking care of one another, those things really do matter for ultimate performance. And that's really what we're shooting for. We're trying to maximize performance of our team.
And does the same crew remain intact for Artemis III?
No, definitely not. There'll be another crew assigned to Artemis III. Even before we fly Artemis II, there'll be a second crew coming behind us and ready to take on that next challenge of sending humans back to the moon. I think it's an important point. You know, Artemis II is meant to be just one next step. It's not a pinnacle, certainly not a pinnacle in the Artemis program. And I think what's important for Canadians to recognize is this is like not the end for us either. I mean, this is just where we've gotten after decades, and we're aiming much, much higher. You know, definitely I won't be satisfied if we don't see a Canadian walk on the moon at some point in the future. And then on to Mars. Canada has a lot to offer. It's one of the things I've been sharing is, you know, it's tremendous American leadership to create a program that makes space for the international partnership. But it's Canada's can-do attitude that has stepped up and taken advantage of that opportunity and is delivering tremendous value. I mean, I am so proud of what I have seen Canadians accomplish across our country over the past 14 years that I've been in the space program. I know they have a lot more to give.
Well, let me pick up on one part of that answer you gave, which is that you said you'd be ticked off if at some point a Canadian doesn't get to walk on the moon again. And and I have to believe, Jeremy, you're going to forgive me for this, I have to believe that there's a small part of you, or maybe a big part of you, that's thinking, I'm going to get so close to the bloody moon and I don't actually get to walk on the moon. Man, am I ticked off. Am I close on that?
No, I don't think so. I don't think you're close at all. I mean, I'll always want to walk on the moon, and I may walk on the moon one day, you know, never say never. But right now, I'm truly, authentically, very pleased and happy to be part of this test flight. This may not look like a big challenge because we're not landing on the moon, but it is.
Earlier this year, we did put out a cyber flash to critical infrastructure partners within Canada, talking about an incident that we were aware of where a critical infrastructure operator had been compromised by a threat actor And in this situation, the threat actor had the potential to actually cause physical damage by the access that they had. So it's very important for us to flag that, to take the information that we learned from the incident and actually share that with critical infrastructure operators across Canada.
Bhushan, I want to come to you. In terms of, give us an idea, is the oil and gas sector routinely targeted by cyber criminals and state-backed leaders, or hackers, rather?
Well, it is. And, you know, we're being critical infrastructure always a source of attack, but I can confirm that Enbridge was not hacked or breached. And we do maintain a very strong partnership and collaboration with the government, so with the Canadian as well as the US security agencies. And part of this is all about making sure that we are sharing the threat intelligence in a more proactive manner so we can take proactive action to address or mitigate any threats.
So just want to confirm that Enbridge is not the natural gas company at the center of this breach.
That is right.
All right. Stephanie, one of the last times you were on the program, you were talking about pipelines and the Colonial Pipeline in specific, one that was a successful cyber attack, a victim of. Give us an idea. Cyber criminals, do they look at oil and gas? Is this an industry that is normally targeted?
Yeah, that Colonial Pipeline attack, it's different from what this alleged attack actually is. In that particular case, it was a ransomware attack, and I don't believe it actually hit the industrial control systems or the systems that basically control the pressure, the flow, the distribution of oil. And it seems to, I think, have attacked kind of the billing department. And so it's a very different kind of attack. It's where basically criminals are able to encrypt information and then stop computers from working and those kinds of things. Then you have to pay a ransom in order to get basically your data back or access to your computers back. In this particular case, what's being alleged is something far more serious. It is something that could have potentially, as been said, caused physical destruction, right? Mm-hmm. So something that could have caused an explosion. Some of the media reports on this a leak basically suggests that this could have potentially even have caused loss of life. So what we're talking about here is an actual kind of physical attack. And, you know, to your point, this is something that does happen regularly in the sector, or at least attempts to do this happen in the sector. We've been, I think, fairly lucky. The intelligence reports allegedly say that this attack had been successful, it would have been the first time we would have seen something like an industrial control system successfully attacked by Russia. But, you know, even going back 10 years ago, there was the Telvent incident, right, which was an attack. It's, you know, it's allegedly China was able to actually get into the smart grid of Telvent's pipelines, which could have caused similar kinds of damage in terms of flows and things like this. That fortunately was detected and stopped at the time. But it goes to show that, you know, these kinds of attacks, aspirational or successful, have been plotted for now well over a decade.
All right, let's add some international context into this. Rajiv, I'm hoping you can explain, how does the Russian war in Ukraine factor into these threats?
Yeah, so absolutely. I mean, the geopolitical tensions that we saw there, and then the actual conflict itself was certainly something that we tracked carefully at the Cyber Center. So, I mean, threats to oil and gas can come from a number of different sources. So they could be from cyber criminals, right? They want to make money because they can, you know, basically ransomware a gas company and then have them pay money because they can't afford to be down. It can come from hacktivists, right? It can come from espionage. They want to learn information about the gas company or its exploration and whatnot. But in this case here, we're looking at the geopolitical context. And what states do is they tend to preposition or perform reconnaissance against oil and gas companies and other energy organizations as well. And we've been warning about that from the Cyber Center since about 2018 in our first national cyber threat assessment. So we've been upping those warnings year after year. It's a way of projection of power for the states. And when you start to get into geopolitical conflict, the stakes just rise even higher, right? So if you look back to before the conflict, in December, we had put out, this is 2021, We made a conscious effort to actually talk about ransomware, and we actually had four ministers sign an open letter to Canadians talking about the threat of ransomware. And as you know, there are many, you know, ransomware groups that are Russian in this space.
Those are just two of the stories we covered this week. You can find more, including the full conversations, on our website, tvo.org, our YouTube channel at youtube.com/theagenda, or our Twitter feed, twitter.com/theagenda.
The Agenda with Steve Paikin is made possible through generous philanthropic contributions from viewers like you. Thank you for supporting TVO's journalism.